Welcome back to On Roads Less Travelled. This trip will take us from Pooncarry through Broken Hill and on up to Milparoonka.
Darling River can be 80 kilometres wide when it's in flood. So we've just been stalking these feral goats at the moment. And you see that big billy goat there? We were here at this campsite 2 years ago and they came to visit. And here they are again. These are feral goats coming down to the Darling River. They're easily drink. And here's some little baby kids eating. This is a mob of probably about 45 goats in all.
Today,
or maybe Milparoonka.
Via Milparoonka.
Is it still a bit soft, is it?
Sand, yeah. I saw a track.
Obviously well loved.
To rescue the town of Cunnamulla from the clutches of starvation.
We're on the Silver City Highway heading for Broken Hill.
Larrikins roamed the streets and publicans were forced to watch.
Thank you.
Imagine travelling a party of 15 men, 200 sheep, 6 drays and a boat, travelling by foot for months over country like this. This morning we left Broken Hill and we followed up and we're currently at Pack Saddle. Is that there? It is. Pack Saddle, and we're heading up to Milparinka for the night. The road widens here to become an airstrip to allow the Flying Doctor Service to fly in and transport patients out to nearby hospitals. We're just driving into Milparinka. This is a great little town filled with Australian history. Our second visit, I love this town. The people are so friendly and it's got great facilities. Well worth a visit. This is the Milparinka lockup. It's a beautiful little town, Milparinka. The lady at the information centre is full of information and I'm too happy to help you with staying the night here in this little caravan park at powered and unpowered sites, and they also have a cabin as well. It's a solid old door. What you're seeing now is part of the Milparinka Historical Society presentation. They've got lots of little buildings, that lining and things that are important to their past. It's an awesome little place. It's drop in and have a look around. It's like a little gem in the desert. This is part of their display as well. Got some lovely old machinery from the pastoral days and probably some from mining as well, I'd imagine. And this old beauty, steam powered. History buff, or just, you know, have a passing interest, great place to visit. So tomorrow we're heading for Innaminka and then Birdsville. And then maybe Innaminka, we'll get to see if the walker track's open, but we'll be going through Strzelecki. So there you can see that in that little corner map. And this tells you a bit about how the Strzelecki Desert was formed. The miners really had no idea what they were into when they came here. Looking for gold. I mean, the land outside is just all rock. Just, can you imagine every day hitting it with a pickaxe like that? Oh my God, or digging
with a shovel. And then doing this, here's a story of gold, the search for gold, using a gold pan. Oh my God, amazing. Just pause the video if you want to read more. I've got that all the way in, there we go. So that's the dry blower being used. See the pump at the bottom? Imagine that in heat of summer. Oh my God. And this is a gold cradle used to separate gold from dirt. So another way of finding the gold amongst all the quartz and dirt and gravel. Up ahead is the amenities block, and then it looks like they've got a barbecue area down the end there as well in the caravan park, I think. Greg paid for it, but I'm not really sure. It's only like $10 a night or something. It was also $10 to get into a museum. You know what? I'm more than happy to give them $10 for all the amazing hard work that they've done. They've got just a fantastic display setup. Now, this is the explorer, Charles Sturt. He also has the desert, the Sturt Stony Desert, named after him. Now remember, just pause if you want to read any of these boards. It is well worth coming to have a look by yourself. Well, I have a room dedicated to Sir Sidney Kidman and his life story. Again, well worth a visit as you head through. It's a lovely little place to stop off. There is a shop up the front. I haven't actually been in there, but I believe it sells beer and soft drinks, and I think it does meals as well, but I'm not 100% certain. This is another display of pastoralists and the life that they led. And that, of course, is for navigating to see the placement of stars in the sky. It's called a sextant. I owned a tugboat many years ago, and we had a sextant that we used for navigating. So this is how the surveyors worked out where a person's plot could be. And this is a 100 link chain. Nowadays we use a tape measure, of course, but back then no such thing existed. Burke and Wills, on their famous expedition to find an inland sea, probably would have camped somewhere similar to this. This is a dry creek bed, but I'm sure in some places, if you dug down deep enough, you would probably find moisture at least, if not water. Although this is a dry creek bed now, you can tell by the depth of the banks that when the rains come, they gush down here. You can see how new watercourses have formed around the various trees as the waters force the soil away and downstream. This would just be a torrent of water. Where I am at the moment is a lovely bush area, or dry creek beds and bush area, that is just below Caravan Park. I can only imagine how beautiful the dawn chorus will be tomorrow morning. I know from camping along outback creeks and rivers, there is always an abundance of wildlife that come in, particularly bird life, along even dry watercourses. Because of course here in outback areas, there's not many other trees, to be quite honest. It's just flat desert-like country, and that's all. So no roosting places for birds to build a nest or raise their young, and not as many insects, because of course the insects would be attracted to the trees and the foliage that are in the dry creek beds. So these dry creek beds, although they don't have water, they'd still supply a great deal of food for small insects and reptiles, and also for other birds, because of course some birds prey on the nestlings of other birds, or they'll take their eggs, or they'll even attack the larger birds, depending on, you know, what type of bird of prey we're talking about. I'm walking along, I can see all manner of things that have been brought down with the flood, bits of tin wrapped around trees and old wheels. Water courses are easily discernible in the landscape by the amount of trees. They're really the only place that there are trees. The rest of the landscape can look like this, barren with just salt bush, small scrubby stuff. But then where there's a water course, dry or not, there's an abundance of the river red gum, which is an iconic Australian tree. And sometimes other trees as well. Maybe some gidgee or similar. It's been a fantastic trip. Tomorrow we head on to Innamincka, which will be really exciting as well. Hopefully you can join us for that. Remember, click subscribe and you won't miss out on any of our videos.